Okay, as I said, the fundamental concept, these are again all the prerequisites that we talked about. Now I am really going to go through the vectors and go through the scalar product, dot product, and mixed triple product. These are the three rules that we are going to follow, and how this scalar product, dot product, and the mixed triple product that is going to be used to solve the engineering mechanics problem related to forces. So first of all, as we all know, that vectors can be, you know, taken, there are two types of vectors, fixed vectors and the free vectors, right? So fixed vectors have well-defined points of application that cannot be changed without affecting an analysis. Whereas free vector, that can be freely moved in the space. Anyone? What is a free vector in engineering mechanics problem? Weakly? Very good. So excellent. So we all know it's a couple moment. So couple is a free vector, right? Okay. So we want to make this interactive again. All right. So that, just keep that in mind. Equal vectors and negative vectors are there. Now we are going to go through the addition of vectors. Now addition of vectors is parallelogram law that we have already defined. We also have the triangle rule that we have to keep in mind. So ultimately, you have P and Q, right? And the other side should be P plus Q, right? So R equals to P plus Q. So laws of cosines come into play. If we want to get the magnitude of the resultant force R, then R squared equals to P squared plus Q squared negative 2PQ cosine of the angle between these two vectors, okay? So laws of sines are also there. Then vector addition is commutative. This is very important. What is happening is that does not matter how I go here. That is P plus Q should be equals to Q plus P. Now if that is not there, then I cannot say that's a vector, okay? Now addition of vectors, that means what we are going to see here, that you can use that rules repeatedly to, you know, when we have more than two vectors in place, so we can just get P plus Q plus S in that way. So now, as I said, a quantity which has magnitude and direction but does not follow parallelogram law cannot be a vector. Anyone, any quantity? Finite rotation, okay. Someone said in the beginning. But we can clearly tell this with examples, very simple example, that finite rotation cannot be a vector, okay? Why? Just take an example of a book. See, first, this is my X, Y, and Z, so I have the book placed. Now you have both magnitude and the direction, that means angle itself is the magnitude, and we also have a clockwise or anticlockwise, that is the direction. So if I do this operation, let's say I rotate the book in this fashion, that is my first operation, and then I will simply move, do the operation number two, right? So I get to this position. This is my P plus Q. But the inverse will not be true. That means if I first do this operation, lift the book, you know, first I make the rotation like this, and then I make the rotation like that, then it is not going to actually be in the same configuration, okay? So finite rotation is something that is, that cannot be termed as a vector. So the application, why we are talking about these vectors now so far, as such we know that basically we have, we have several concurrent forces, so we have to really solve the problems that involves the concurrent forces where all the forces meet at a particular point. Okay, so therefore, when we are solving this type of problems, when forces are meeting at a particular point, which we call the concurrent forces, we have to use this kind of laws, okay? Again, the rectangular components of a vector. So that was given in terms of the trigonometry. Now we can also define the vector in the rectangular coordinates. So we have basically the force F that is has, you know, Fx and Fy. So these are just component-wise display, and we have to make sure there is a unit vector. So the force vector F will be taken as Fxi plus Fyj. Okay. So addition of vectors, you know, when we have more than one vector, that means one force, so we have three forces here. So three forces can be also added as per our rectangular components. So basically, we will have R equals to P plus Q plus S, and all of us know that there is going to be Rx, that means X component of the resultant force and the Y component of the resultant force. So this is going to be, you know, then they will make an angle theta, which is tan inverse Ry over Rx, okay? So let's take an example. As soon as we do this, so we do this exercise, then we are actually going to go through the problems, how to deal with the problem of concurrent forces, okay? Just to apply this knowledge that students will develop through this. So the first example where we have two forces, these two bars are actually bolted with a, let's say, a bracket or a gusset plate. You see the similar example is actually for a truss. In case of a truss member, we'll see that there are multiple members that are actually connected at a particular joint. So that gives a quick a feedback of what the concurrent forces would be. And the two forces are given here, let's say 20 kilonewton and 30 kilonewton. We are interested in find out, first, using trigonometric rule, that means the triangle rule or parallelogram law, using that, can I find out the resultant force of these two forces that is acting in these two members? Okay. So ultimately, the solution key is what we look at. So once we give the problem, student has to do some kind of brainstorming and try to come up with what would be my expected answer. That is the first thing. So here, we can actually guess the resultant force, how it would actually look like. So that would be the guess that we actually try to see whether students are capable of doing it or not. So as such, this problem is very simple problem to begin with. So we just draw the, use the trigonometry. So I have one force here, 20 kilonewton, and the other force is 30 kilonewton, and the resultant is going to look like this. So if they draw it in a scale, I can immediately figure out what is the resultant force and its direction. So as such, we are not really going to go through all the solution, but main intention will be just the demonstrate the problem and look at, can we solve it in one go or not. All the engineering mechanics problem will be like that only. Okay. So ultimate answer would be, as we see, that this one students should be able to get a visualization, okay, my resultant force is going to look like this. Next, now here, we have more than two forces actually, so we have three forces, and it is an example of a scalar. Now what it is, in a simple sense, we use the umbrella every day. Basically, you have a hollow cylinder that is gliding against a rod or a bar. That's a collar. Now remember, in that collar, all the spokes are coming and meeting at that collar, okay? So here, the problem is defined in such a way that determine the value of angle for which the resultant of the three forces is horizontal. So what condition is given that the resultant forces is going to be horizontal? The corresponding magnitude of the resultant. So therefore, what would be my solution? That student has to immediately tell that, okay, that means you are saying that Ry equals to zero. That condition is going to give me the angle that is unknown. That angle, unknown angle, will be alpha. Right? And then what is the magnitude of the resultant, that is going to be R equals to simply sum of all the forces along x direction, right? Because already we said Ry equals to 0. Okay. So if we look at the solution, since R is horizontal, therefore Ry equals to 0, so we just take the component of all these forces along the y-axis and set it equals to 0. So we get the solution for the alpha. And then we look at the next part of it, that is part B. So what is the resultant force now? So resultant force is, of course, going to be horizontal. So the resultant force will be simply sum of all the forces along the x direction. Now we can also tell them about the rectangular component in the space, but logic remains same as such. So we don't have to go through here. But what is most important that we tend to say is the unit vector lambda, how they calculate that unit vector, that is very, very important that we should highlight again and again. So that calculation actually plays a very important role when we solve this kind of problem in the space. Now the scalar product of two vectors, as we know that if we have two vectors P and Q, then P dot Q should be equals to PQ cosine theta. Remember that P dot Q can be also written down in rectangular components, and the components will simply look like this. Okay. Now, what is the main purpose of doing the scalar product? What we can do in terms of forces with the scalar product? Anyone? What would be the application when it comes to the forces?
Projection of the
nice. So the answer is done. So it is actually projection of the force onto a line, and that is what we use the scalar product. Okay. So that is the first thing we have to keep in mind. So it is used for two different purposes. One is that we can definitely calculate the angle between the two forces if it is not right. So if we have the force vector here and force vector here, we should be able to get the angle between these two. And the second one is the very important that what is the projection of this force onto this line lambda? So that can only be done by lambda dot product with P. So the projection of the force onto a line, that is bringing in the essence of scalar product. Okay, and that we will be doing many times in this course. Next is the vector product. So as such that we have P and Q, two vectors, so the cross product will be perpendicular to the plane of P and Q, and the magnitude of this cross product, which is giving me V, should be PQ sine theta, and make sure that direction of V should form a right hand rule, right? So we have to apply the right hand rule to get the direction of the force that is in the third direction than P and Q. So in this case, what would be the quick application of this again when it comes to the forces? Where do I use P cross Q? Exactly. So the ultimately what we have is the calculation of the moment, so that therefore, let's say we have a rigid body and the force is applied at F, which is located as at a distance OA, so that is my position vector R. So R cross F should give the moment, which is actually perpendicular to the plane defining R and F, and make sure we are also using the right hand thumb rule. Okay. Remember, what is important here is to look at what is the magnitude of this moment. That magnitude of the moment should be F times D, where D is the shortest distance between the line force and the origin O, right? Now, once we do this, we can see a large number of problems that deals with a moment, and moment is probably the most important concept in engineering mechanics, because what we find that student has real difficulty getting the moment. Probably, you know, when they do it R cross F, they may get the numbers correctly, but the visualization, that is going to be really, really difficult for them, that which direction it is going to actually act. Okay, so that type of things we have to kind of throw them. So as such, when we want to use the vector mechanics, so here we have moment is R cross F, right? And this can be, to get the moment, we can write it down in this fashion. So it is going to be, basically we are going to take at the determinant of this matrix, and that is going to get in this form. Now we can also do component wise. That means if we break fx, fy, and fz, each of these forces, each of these components is actually going to give me the moment about, let's say, O, that is the origin. And remember, for example, if I want to calculate moment about the y-axis, then actually two forces will affect the moment about the y-axis. They are going to be fx, the component fx will affect, as well as the component fz. Okay, so like that also we can tell students that in complex problem, okay, you may want to just use the R cross F directly, but in simplified problem, it is always better to look at component wise. So instead of taking the moment at the origin, let's say I take the moment of this force which is applied at A with respect to point B. So moment is taken about B, therefore what is necessary at the first place to calculate the position vector from B to A. So we'll get the RBA basically, and we know the F. So again, we are going to use the R cross F, and the ultimately it will be put together like this to find the moment about B. So let's look at one more example. So this is actually to deal with a shower head. And let's say a mechanic came and tried to tighten the shower head with a wrench. Okay. So once we see this problem, so the force is applied. Look at the force, how it is actually applied on the shower head. It will definitely have three components, right? And these three components, we can find out what are these components actually. So just briefly explain this problem. This force that is being applied at C, if you look at this shower head C here, that is the range where the force is applied, then this is actually 15 millimeter down from the Z axis. Or in other words, you have the XZ plane, it is actually 15 millimeter down from the XZ plane, okay? It is also oriented with respect to an axis which is parallel to the Z axis. So this is actually 12 degree, right? So first of all, you know, procedure is very straightforward. Question is here, can we ask the students what kind of direction I'm looking at for the ultimate moment vector? The moment that is going to be produced at A, the direction of that vector, how it should look like? Just tell me component wise. Anyone? You can tell me, okay, it is along the x-axis or maybe negative x-axis. One component will be like this, another component will be like that. Anyone? Quickly. So just think of R cross F. That plane, just draw that plane. So how that plane is going to look like? We have RAC, right? That is my R. Okay, and when we do R cross F, the moment should be perpendicular to that plane. That means the answer that I am actually looking at, not about ZS, one component. Yes, sir, just go ahead. Anyone? Positive y, that is good. One component will be positive y component. Another component? Negative z. Okay, that is what I was actually looking at. See, you are going to get ultimately two components. Those are going to be positive, x and y. But one component, that is actually z component, that is going to be negative. Right? So we need to define this plane here. That plane will look like something like this. So this will be my plane, and it is going to be kind of, you know, within the wall of that shower head where it is attached. Okay. So ultimately, you know, that do this process is, again, simple, but breaking up the component into forces would be very important. So we can see that there are three components of forces. The force component X, how do I get this? So you have basically first we bring it onto this plane. So I have cosine of 45 degree, right? Then we move to parallel to the x-axis. So that will be sine 12 degree. So I first bring it to here and then move sine of 12 degree. So that is my x component. Make sure that is negative. Similarly, if I look at the z component, let's say, so z component will also be negative. So ultimately, it is going to point like this. Okay. So I have x component, y component, and z component. Remember, y component is relatively easy because y component is just f sine 45 degree, which is parallel to the y-axis, and it is pointing downward. So difficulty is getting the x component of the force and the z component of the force correctly. Now, when we want to do it in a component-wise, let's say I want to see the moment about x-axis, what are the forces actually going to contribute to the moment about x-axis, then it's a bit difficult in this problem. So maybe student will just prefer to do this one r cross f. Okay, once they do r cross f, but as I said, that intuitively, we have to make sure they get the final answer correctly. And as some of you have said, that I am expecting really negative answer for the z. So z component of moment should be negative, and x and y should be positive. Just look at the direction of it. See, ultimately, if you really break it into components, so you are coming to, first of all, f cosine 45 degree. That brings you to this line, and it is directed towards negative, right, z-axis. Not the axis, actually, there's an inclined axis here. So ultimately, now you are going to take this one into sine. So ultimately, you see this force is going to be like that, with its tip should be heading towards the negative x-axis. So the arrow should be along the negative x-axis. Okay? So as I said, moment is always that gives trouble to students. I mean, this is what we have to know. This is just a coordinator workshop. I can't look at a number of problems. But ultimately, what will happen in the main workshop, we are actually going to give multiple problems to the students just to get a feeling of how the moment should look like. They can simply sketch the R cross F plane and show it by pictures that, OK, this figure, you know, moment is going to be like this direction. Now, mixed triple product. So this involves three forces, as if looks like. So P, Q, and S. And the mixed triple product is going to be S dot P cross Q, right? Ultimate outcome is that I am going to get a scalar quantity. And that scalar quantity represents the volume of parallel pipe. So because P cross Q, that will simply give me the area, right, the magnitude of it, right? And when you are doing S dot P cross Q, so S dot P cross Q actually going to give the height here, right? So height multiplied by area, so that is giving me the volume of the parallel pipe. Okay. Now, what is the application, basic application of S dot P cross Q in a engineering mechanics. Anyone? Related to moment, projection of moment on an axis. So it is actually related to moment of a force about an arbitrary axis on the space. So let us say that I have a force applied at A. What is that moment of this force about an axis OL? Let's say this line is passing through the origin O. Then simply we can say the moment is going to be, this is again a scalar quantity, moment about that axis OL is simply going to be lambda dot r cross f, where lambda is the unit vector of that line. Now remember, if the axis is not passing through O, let's say you have some arbitrary axis, but the unit vector is defined, we can still calculate the moment of the force about any arbitrary axis. So for example, I have here this axis which is not passing through O, but this axis, let's say I have points here, B and C. So what is the moment of this force about this axis? Simply lambda dot MB. Now what is my MB? MB is R cross F, right? So to get the MB, first of all, I get the moment about a point B, right? And then I take the projection of that moment onto that line. So lambda dot R cross F, where R is simply this vector BA. Now instead of taking BA, can I actually take CA? RCA? Answer is yes. So it does not matter. It is independent where that point is. It could be A, it could be B. I should get the same answer. Now this is another very important point. Okay? And you can clearly see that if I want to prove that my answer would be same, does not matter whether I choose a B and C, right? So I can simply say that lambda dot r cross f, I had this. Now r can be broken, that's r ba can be broken into two parts. One is the bc and another is the ca. Right? So now once you break it into two parts, let's say r ba and r bc, one component will be simply zero because that cannot make the volume of the parallel pipe. That means this RBC, lambda dot RBC cross F will have no make sense. That has to be zero. Okay. The other component will give you the moment. So ultimately, we can show that MB should be equals to MC. Okay. Now, we can just come to a quick example of this. We have a frame ACD. This frame is actually hinged at A and D. Probably student at this time does not have any background that whether you know he or she understands the hinge or not, does not matter, irrelevant. But this problem is stated like this, that let's say I have a frame ACD and it is supported by a cable that passes through a ring at B and is attached to hooks at G and H. What is given actually, that the tension in the cable is 1125 newton. So determine the moment about the diagonal AD of the force exerted on the frame by portion BH of the cable. So I am really interested in that what moment this force on this cable BH will produce with respect to this moment about AD. So this is again a moment of a force about an axis, and that axis is AD. Okay. So I do have here tension in this cable is, let's say, BH. So that I have to first show. This is my force vector. And I am really taking the moment of this force vector about the AD. So first, let us try to understand this way. Can we get the direction correctly? What would be my direction of the moment? Remember, I'm going to get a scalar quantity, right? Yes, it is along, no, it is not along AB. I am trying to get the moment about AD, right? And let's say I define my lambda as lambda AD. Let's say I define lambda as lambda AD. That means tip of the arrow is the towards D. What answer I am expecting, positive or negative? If I say my lambda is from A to D, right? Then it is going to, you just look at the hand. So I have this force distance. So ultimately, my thumb is going not from A to D, but rather from D to A. So ultimately, I am expecting a negative answer. Okay. So once we give this feedback to the students, or let them first think that what is the expected answer, then others can be done. Actually, others are just mathematical process as such. So they just find out, okay, first I have to choose a point on this line AD. Let's say that point is A, right? They can also choose the point D, does not matter. Define the lambda AD. So what is the lambda AD? Then I define the position vector from A to B, which is RAB, right? And once these are defined, I also know what is TBH in vector form. So basically, I need lambda, I need R, and I need T. Then I can calculate the moment as lambda dot R cross F, which is again a scalar quantity, and the answer will be negative 180 Newton meter. Okay? So basically, that's how, you know, we tend to kind of impart this, you know, at the beginning of the problem, that can you guess the answer? Just the direction. Direction absolutely plays a very, very important role. I'll just take 5 minutes to finish it off. So couple or couple moment, again, this is a very simple logic. And ideally, we have two forces, F and negative F, having the same magnitude, parallel lines of action, and opposite sense, they should form a couple, right? So we can actually think of a steering, very easy example, okay? So remember, at the very beginning of the, you know, this session, we said that this is going to be a free vector, okay? And basically, F times D should be the moment that I am looking at, that's the magnitude of the moment, and that is going to be perpendicular to the plane where the couple lies. So I'm going to get this moment vector, which is actually perpendicular to this plane. Now, without affecting the equilibrium, this moment can be transferred anywhere when I'm going to take the equilibrium, right? So it does not depend on the position of that moment. Okay. So two couples will have equal moments if and only if these three criteria are satisfied. That means, let's say I'm talking about a couple F1 here and F2 here. These two can only be same if and only if F1 multiplied by D1 equals to F2 multiplied by D2. That means their magnitude, the moment magnitude has to be same. Two couples must lie in parallel planes. Right, they have to be parallel to each other. And two couples have same sense or tendency to cause the rotation in the same direction. Like moment we can add, since it's a vector, couple can also be added. Similar methodology we will follow. So ultimately, we have, let's say, here actually two planes are given. One is having the couple F1, you can see F1 and negative F1, that is on the plane P1. The other couple is on the plane P2. Okay. And in a similar way, we can simply say that the resultant moment of these two couples should be just sum of the individual couple moment, which is M1 plus M2. So this M1 vector will act perpendicular to P1, M2 vector will act perpendicular to the P2, and we can simply add these to get the moment, okay? So in summary, a tuple can always be represented by a vector with magnitude and direction equal to the moment of the tuple, that is F multiplied by D. Tuple vectors also obey the law of addition of vectors. I can always add two tuples, and they are free vectors, and their point of application is not significant. And tuple vectors can also be resolved in component wise, like the moment. So their performance is same as moment, but we do not have a definite point of application of this moment that is coming out. Okay, so now we can just take a tea break, and we can start our next topic that will be on equivalent force couple system.